reels. Here we are on the 10th day of July, 1961, out at Merle Travis' house in Van Nuys. And this is the beginning of a project that will probably take some time of collecting the total folklore of Merle Travis. And the best way we can start is for you to tell me about your background, where you came from, when you were born, those things.
Well, as far as folklore is concerned, Ed, if I know any, I didn't know I knew it until I went to the city. Because down in Kentucky, you asked where I was born. I was born in southwestern Kentucky, Muhlenberg County. The county seat of Muhlenberg is Greenville. Now, I never heard it said that way, you know, until I got out from there, because we always said Greenville. And I live close to a little coal mining town. It was called Drakesboro, Drakesboro. Now, we didn't say it that way down home, and they still don't. It's Drakesboro.
Drakesboro?
Drexber, Drakesboro. You know, it's always been a funny thing of mine when I run into somebody and they say, "Where are you from?" I'll say, "Well, you know where Kentucky is?" And they say, "Yeah, oh yeah." I'll say, "Well, do you know where Muhlenberg County is?" And they say, "Yeah." That's southwest Kentucky. I say, "Good. Do you know where Greenville is?" "Yeah." "Well, do you know where Drakesboro is?" "Yeah." "Well, do you know where Ebenezer is?" That's 3 miles from Drakesboro. "Yeah." And now if they know that, I say, "Well, you know where the old Reed place is?" "Yeah." And I say, "That's where I was raised." So I wasn't born on the old Reed place. That was a company house, belonged to the Beach Creek Coal Mining Company, and my dad rented it from the company. I guess I was 7 when we moved there. I was born in Rosewood, Kentucky, which is also in Muhlenberg County. They raised tobacco up there. My dad raised tobacco, and my oldest brother, Taylor, he moved to Muhlenberg County and got a job in the mines. So he went back to Rosewood and told Dad, you, "Pappy, you're crazy raising this tobacco." Said, "You can go down to the mines and really make some money." So Dad spent the rest of his days after going to the mines in Browder, Kentucky. And then, of course, eventually to Beach Creek, where he worked 16 years. Dad always said, "I wish I'd have stayed on the farm, you know." But I think he kind of liked coal mining. So that is where I was born and raised.
Now, when were you born?
I was born November 17th, 1917. That was the year of the bad winter.
That's how they tell it.
Yeah. Dad always said it was year of the bad winter.
And how many kids were there in your family?
Well, it was 4 of us. And we're all still living, the kids, thank goodness. Mom and Dad passed on. My oldest brother's named Taylor. He was born 1900. And then my sister, Vady. We say Vady, but her name is V-A-D-A. I suppose some would say Veda, but she would faint, I guess, if she wasn't called Vady. She was my sister, 4 years younger than Taylor, and then Vady. She was born in 1904. Now, 13 years passed, and my brother next to me was born. You met him.
John.
Well, now, there's another thing. I tell you, is this too much?
Mm-mm.
Now, John, when he was living around Drakesboro and Ebenezer, you know, why, he was Melvin. His name is John Melvin Travis. Well, he always went by the name of Melvin, you know. And my sister and, of course, Taylor, still Vady and Taylor, they still call him Melvin, and everybody around Muhlenberg County. But he lives in Hopkinsville now, in Hopkinsville, Kentucky, and he's known as John. He thought it looked better, you know, John M. Travis, and besides, he thought John was a little bit better than Melvin. I might add that my brother Taylor is living in Evansville, Indiana now. We always said Evansville, but it's Evansville on the Ohio River. And most people know him as Andy. His name is Andrew Taylor Travis.
I'll be darned.
Vady still lives down in Muhlenberg County. She ain't changed her name, and neither have I.
Well, now, where were your parents from?
Both of them was born in Muhlenberg County. as a kid, I always said Pappy and Mammy. Well, I've taught myself not to say that. I say Dad and Mom, you know, because I was laughed at a little bit when I first started picking and saying it. Anyway, Dad was born up around Rosewood, and Mom was born up pretty close to Logan County, which is a neighbor county of Muhlenberg. Either Logan or Todd, I don't know. My dad's father and mother, my grandfather and grandmother, was born in North Carolina. And it's always been a story among the Travises that, you know, that's where William Barrett Travis of the Alamo was from, was North Carolina. And Dad always said, oh, they're the same set of dogs. So, I guess so. And my mother's folks was Irish. And my grandmother on my dad's side was second generation of Irish. My mother was a North, of the descendant of the North Irish, and my dad's folks was from County Cork, which is down in the southern part of Ireland, you know. So my mother had dark eyes and dark hair, and my dad had the real light blue eyes and the jowls and the face typical of the County Cork Irish.
Well, now, what are the first things you remember about when you were a kid in life in Kentucky, in your family life, that kind of thing?
Well, the first thing I remember, you want to along about the music or just anything?
Just about anything. Just
any old thing? I guess about the first thing I remember was living on the old Little Page place. Now, that was an old two-story house that was built, I understand, just before the Civil War in Muhlenberg County, over by Browder. There's the telephone.
Okay, well, I'll turn this off and you can get the phone.
Oh, that's all right. They'll get it outside.
Okay.
Now, this old Little Page place was between Beach Creek and Browder in Kentucky, and I believe the story goes this way, that the people were English, their name was Little Page, and they had slaves before the Civil War, and when the war broke out, well, they took off and went back to England and gave the place to their slaves, who was named Little Page. Now, the first memories that I have is of Uncle Rufus and Aunt Rowena, Little Page. Uncle Rufus and Aunt Rowena. They lived down under the hill by an old country coal mines, you know. And my dad rented from them. So our landlord and landlady was formerly slaves. And we was taught to call them Uncle Rufus and Aunt Rowena, and they lived until I was grown, and I was the youngest of the Travis clan. Now, these are early memories. I remember that Uncle Rufus, when he'd collect the rent, he used to come to the back door and take his hat off, you know. And he'd say, Miss Travis, I believe it's time for the rent, ma'am. And she'd say, yes, Uncle Rufus, of course. Would you come in? He said, no, ma'am, I'll wait out here. It was customary, and we loved them, and they loved us, I believe, and I'm sure they did, because we had lots of visits. He was sort of my Uncle Remus, him and another old colored gentleman I can think of right now, named Uncle Lum Martin, but more about him when you ask about whatever you want to.
Okay. Well, now, what about your first musical memories?
Well, the first musical memories I can think of, you know, I feel like I'm talking to a psychiatrist. Ed, you're a good one.
It shouldn't be that way.
The first musical memories I can think of, I was always fascinated by things about music. For instance, the reason I say things about music, now we had a neighbor, and his name was Maynard Matherly. And they had a guitar hanging on the wall, and I remember that somebody, and I don't know, maybe Mr. Matherly or Ms. Matherly, played the guitar, and it smelled so good. You know, it had the round hole, and it had a musty sort of smell, and I imagine the strings, the whole set must have cost a quarter. But it was the most fascinating-looking thing, you know, and then these are outside things. You know, there was music in the home, of course. Then there was a fellow named Coley Addison who played the fiddle and he played the guitar and the old Taterbug mandolin. And that just sounded the prettiest that ever I heard to me. And, of course, in home, why, my dad was a five-string banjo picker. But he didn't have a banjo. And he talked about the old-time banjo players. I remember he used to talk about a guy named Jim Winders, who was a great banjo player. So finally, my dad's brother, named John, Uncle Johnny Travis, he got a five-string banjo, and Dad traded him out of it, and brought it home, and Dad, he'd play, pick it, you know. They had two different ways. He called it knocking a banjo and then picking a banjo, you know. He'd sing songs. He'd sing Jenny Weaver and a song about Jeff Davis swore when the cruel war begun, I wouldn't be the Union man and carry the Union gun. But I'd rather be the Union man and carry the Union gun than to be the rebel. The rebel had to run. That was the words to the song he sung. And, of course, he sung some little old verses to Ida Red and a bunch of stuff. Just a world of things he'd pick on the banjo and sing them. And even my mother played a little bit. She played what they call, we call it hot corn. Now, you've heard green corn?
Mm-hmm.
Green corn, hot corn. I've heard it called two or three different things since I've grown up. But she called it hot corn, and that's the first thing I ever learned to play was hot corn on the banjo. And, of course, all kids make instruments. I used to make banjos out of carbide cans, you know, just cut the bottom of a round can off and put a neck on it and a strip of screen wire. That's where I got my strings. And, oh, I'd just pick it, and I wish I had an instrument sound as good today.
What'd you use for a head?
Well, you know, it's like the bottom of a bucket.
Oh, I see. You use the bucket itself, the carbide can itself for the resonator.
Yeah.
I see.
Just like cutting the bottom of a bucket off.
Mm-hmm.
And then turn it upside down with the empty part down and then whittle you out a neck out of anything. A broomstick or a paling, you know. In town they call them picket fences, but in the country down where I was raised we call them paling fences. Anyhow, I get a board and we'd heat a poker. I used to heat a poker, you know, in the fireplace, and then take it out and burn a hole in there, and then whittle me out a wooden peg and stick it through. Maybe my instruments would have one string or two strings, you know. Stick it through that burnt hole, and then I'd string her up with a screen wire, and then I was ready to go.
There are no frets or anything like that on the instrument.
No, and that's a funny thing, Ed. My dad always talked about the banjos without a fret. Now, he lived until early 40s, and he always talked about the banjos, you know. He saw some awfully good ones, because I was working on a radio station at the time he passed on, but until his dying day, why, he said no banjo sound as good as the kind that Jim Winders used to play, made out of a hickory rim and a groundhog hide for the head, and they didn't have no frets on them. Dad said they got in the way. So I don't know how Jim Winder's banjo would sound. I'd love to hear it.
Well, now, what instruments were played in your home when you were a kid?
Well, there was a banjo, and Dad played the French harp. He could, he said, he could just make one talk. He played a tune called Sweet Marie, and a tune called Piggy and the Button, and a lot of stuff like that on the French harp, we call them. Now, harmonica, I never heard until, you know, till I left on it. The mouth organ or the harmonica at home was a French harp. And Dad, he played them, and he played a lot of different tunes on them. And then we'd borrow a guitar here and there, and people would come in. My sister-in-law, the girl that my oldest brother Taylor married, she played with her thumb and finger and just played good.
On the guitar?
Yes, on the guitar. You'd love to hurt her, and she still plays good. And two or three tunes, like me and my brother, John, that you've met, was talking a while back. Nobody could play a tune. Now, Lost John, she called it. It's no kin to the one that you and I know about, Lost John standing on the railroad track, you know. But it was a tune that she played and called it Lost John. And let's see, she played another one called The Devil and Old Aunt Dinah. And we was talking, and nobody could play them like she could. Just fantastic.
Hmm.
So that was the guitar around home. I never heard my dad make a chord on a guitar. The first one that I ever learned very much to mount anything on, if I have learned anything, was one my brother built. My brother Taylor, he built one, and then he went to Evansville and got a job in a factory. And he made this one out of just, I don't know, just planks and boards and things, you know. But it was a beautiful thing to me, and I wasn't allowed to mess with it too much. But when he went to Evansville and got a job, he wrote back and said, you know, I've got a job and so forth, and all this I wasn't interested in. But down at the bottom of the letter, he said, tell Merle he can have the guitar. So I was real proud.
How old were you then?
I'd have to guess. I imagine I was about 10, 9 or 10.
Now, up to that time, the only thing you'd really played was a five-stringer.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, try to play a French harp and a juice harp.
Yeah.
Now, that's another pronunciation, you know, the juice harp. It is Jew's harp, J-E-W-S harp, but I think any Kentuckian or most any country boy would call them juice harps.
Juice harps.
Yeah, and not one out of 100 knows it's J-E-W-S, juice harp.
Hmm.
Juice harp and a French harp and a guitar and a banjo and a mandolin. An awful lot of people call them mandolines and taterbugs, you know.
And what was that last one?
Taterbug.
Taterbug?
Yeah, you know why?
No.
Well, the old taterbug mandolins was made out of little strips of wood and was shaped like a beetle, you know, the back of a beetle. They're not flat at all, just flat on top where the strings were. And on the back, it was round like a watermelon. But they was built out of strips of wood of different color, and they had stripes down the back. And now there's a bug that any country boy that, and who hasn't, had to go out and pick tater bugs off of the vine. They get awful familiar with them little fellers. They look just like a mandolin, you know. They've got the stripes down their back and everything.
Hmm.
So everybody calls them tater bug, you know. He can play a tater bug real good, or some people says he's got a tater bug mandolin.
Well, now, the mandolins that you played there, they were flat back, weren't they? They weren't round back.
No, round back.
They were round back.
Yeah, just like a beetle, just like a half a watermelon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Then when did they start using the flat back mandolins?
The first one I ever seen was built by the Gibson Company. And they started building a flat back mandolin. The first one, that was the first one I ever saw. And, of course, I guess every musical instrument company builds them now that builds any kind of mandolin. And the old taterbug mandolin's a little hard to come by.
Still see them around. They're harder to hold, though.
Yeah, scoot out of your lap.
Yeah. Well, now, how old were you when you first started playing the banjo?
Oh, I guess, let's see. We was living at the old Little Page place when Dad traded Uncle Johnny out of that one. So I must have been, I was under 7. I guess about 5 years old I was trying to pick it.
Then when you were about 10, you started playing the guitar.
Yeah, yeah. Learned this little chord and that one, and my brother John, the one next to me, a little older than I am, well, he could always outpick me, you know. Somehow or another, I got in the business trying to make a living out of it, and he makes an honest living. But we'd pick, you know, just pick away, and of course we had our idols. Mose Reger was the guy that I just idolized, He Mose Reger and Ike Everly, and I might say Luster English, was the guys that I just idolized. They were my heroes. Not baseball players, not boxers. Mose Reger, Ike Everly, and Luster English.
And what kind of picking was it that they did mainly?
Well, they done the thumb and finger picking, you know, whereas you play the accompaniment with your thumb, sort of a oompa-oompa bass, you know, and then you play the melody with... They used one finger. Now, there's a lot of boys nowadays that's developed styles with two fingers and three fingers, and, you know, and just perfected it. But the first picking of that sort was that I ever heard was with my sister-in-law and Mose Reger, Ike Everly, and Luster English. And Luster was the first rhythm man I ever knew, you know. He would use his thumb pick, but he'd play rhythm on a guitar.
Hmm.
You know, with a thumb pick, just ching, 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 just as we say now, like a powerhouse, you know,
yeah.
Like a pile driver.
Well, now, how did you start making a living when you had to do that?
How do you mean?
When did you start going out and trying to earn money doing one thing or another?
Well, let me light a cigarette and I'll tell you about that, Ed.
Okay. Well, we're back to how you were making a living.
How I started.
Mm-hmm.
The first money I ever made playing...
Not just playing, but just any kind of a living.
Well, money was pretty scarce around when I was a kid. Dad worked at the coal mines right during a bad period. I mean, you know, when I was a kid, most everybody was in debt. The coal mines didn't run enough, you know, work enough to actually have a payday and go down and get money, but everybody had credit at the company stores, so once every week, why, they would do what they call put in an order, you know. Mammy would write out, my mother would write out what she wanted and what she needed, and Dad would go to Beach Creek to work, and he'd leave that order at the company store, and a feller, we'd hear a wagon coming down through the woods, you know, and Mammy'd say, yonder comes the order, and it would have whatever we needed, even, you know, shirts and overalls and shoes, which we didn't wear in the summertime too much, but in the wintertime you had to have them. Don't believe the comic pictures of the hillbillies, you know, barefooted. I've always thought, wonder what they do in the wintertime, you know, wonder what the cartoonist thinks. Because it got good and cold. It does all over the United States, sure, I think, except maybe some of the far south places like Florida and Brownsville, Texas. And Southern California is pretty mild, but I've seen times I wouldn't want to go barefooted here. Now, that is where we got our money, and so money was pretty scarce as far as me making any. First money, I guess, that I remember making any big money was with a fella, his name was Floyd Ball. And Floyd, he would buy a sheep and a calf, say, and he would butcher them, and he was a good butcher. He'd cut them up into chops and steaks and all this stuff, you know, and he had an old A model Ford, just it was pretty new then, you know, but it was he had it, and he had a little box built on the back of it, and he'd peddle meat, and it was cold and there's snow on the ground, and I got 50 cents a day. Now that was big money going around with Floyd Ball, and he'd ring the bell, and the wives, you know, they'd come out of these shotgun houses over Beach Creek and Nonell and Drexburg and Browder and Cleeton and Belton and even all the way up to Lewisburg. Now, these are the places that we peddled meat. And if it was so many pork chops or something, why, Mr. Ball would say, you get out there and give them so many pork chops, let them pick out what they want, you know. And so I was in the meat business. I guess I must have worked for a week and a half.
And then what? How old were you then?
I have to guess at these things. I guess about 12, maybe 13. Now, and then what?
Well, yeah.
The next big money, big tycoon that I became was when I joined the CCC camp. I was 15, I guess. 15, something like 15 or 16. 15, I imagine. I joined the CCC camp with dreams of going way off to places that, you know, very few people ever got to. Places like Utah or Colorado. Some of the boys done that. And I joined just knowing that I would go to one of these faraway places. We went to Fort Knox for a couple of weeks, and then I was sent to my regular camp, and that was Columbus, Kentucky, way off from home, at least 125 or 30 miles. I stayed in there about a month or two, and then I caught a freight train and went home and went back and everything. I never was much of a, wasn't a very good CCC boy, I'll tell you. But I learned a lot of things in the CC camp. I learned that I got paid enough money that when I got out, I bought me a Gretsch guitar. I caught a freight train when I got home. So much money was sent home, you know, and then the boy got to rest. And I told my folks all I wanted was a guitar. And I caught the L&N train to Owensboro down on the Ohio River, and then I caught a train out of there to Evansville, Indiana, to the Howell Railroad Yards. That's H-O-W-E-L-L, Howell Railroad Yards. Then my brother, he lived there, Taylor, you know, so I went up to Taylor's and went down to a music store a few days, and I bought this fine Gretsch guitar. I think it must have cost about $20. And boy, I was happy. Now, I stayed and hung around there in Evansville, and one night, why, Taylor said, they're having a walk-a-thon, a marathon, down on Franklin Street. So me and Taylor went down there, And they was broadcasting, and these people, you know, the girl would be asleep, and the boy would be walking around and was dancing. They were supposed to be music playing, you know. But they would broadcast from there over radio station WGBF. And they had some entertainers and everything. Well, Taylor, he's quite a boy, you know, so he flogged up there and told the people, said, my little brother here said he's got a guitar and said he can really pick it. He's a liar, too, you know. So they decided to put me on the next night to do a tune. And I went down the next night with that Gretsch guitar, and I got up and I played Tiger Rag just as much like Mose Rigger as I could. That's the first lick I ever hit on the radio.
You were 15, 16 then?
16, I guess.
16. And then then after that, did you decide that making an honest living was too much for you?
You know, I never did decide whether or not I was going to play for money. I never even gave it a thought. I just played because I liked to. Now, there was some guys, their name was Freddie and L.G. James, and I forgot what the fiddler and the bass fiddler's name was. It slipped my mind. They called themselves the Knox County Knockabouts. So they offered me a job. Now, the job consisted of all of us lived in one room. I could have stayed over Taylor's, you know, but I wanted to be real professional about this thing. We all lived in one room, must have cost about $5 a week. And we lived on pork and beans and bologna sausage, Coca-Colas. And we'd go out and play schoolhouses, you know, little country schools. They're about done away now, you know, with, and just anywhere, a little place, we used to play a place called the Mecca Cafe, and we'd get a dollar, or sometimes 75 cents, sometimes 30 cents, you know, and we was in business at least. Now, I forgot about some more money that I used to make hoboing and hitchhiking and riding steamboats around the country. I can tell you about that if it wouldn't be too boresome. Well, there was a feller, his name was Raymond McClellan. He still lives down in Muhlenberg County. You must go see Raymond. Have you met him?
No.
He knows 1,000 songs, and he was a funny-looking little feller, you know, and he had cross eyes and little and short and had a nasal way of speaking, you know, and his lower lip stuck out, and he was a comical little feller and knew it, and he was a one-man show. My dad was always glad to, when I brought Raymond McClellan over home, because he'd just sing one song after the other, and then he'd tell jokes, you know, like, well, I was on the train the other day, and a preacher come back and said, Raymond, do you want to go to heaven? I said, well, I was going to Louisville. If I don't go up there, I might go with you. And little thing, you know, about the little boy sat down to the table, and he said, hello there, Beans, I like not know you. He had 1,000 little jokes he'd tell, and Dad would like to hear them over and over. Well, me and Raymond used to go on hobo trips, and we'd play on the street corners, you know. And people would give us nickels and dimes. We'd go to faraway places like Springfield, Tennessee, and Paducah, Kentucky, and Fulton, Tennessee, and Kentucky, and Indiana, and them places, you know. Now, the steamboat story is a little bit longer one, you know. I used to ride steamboats a lot with a fellow named Junior Rose. And I believe we're about run out of tape. If you would like to hear the Junior Rose story, well, we can tell it on the next tape.
Okay, I'll do it. All right. You can tell about Junior Rose.
Oh, yeah. Now, Junior was a mandolin player. He played the mandolin and lived over at Powderly, Kentucky. That's between Central City and Greenville. Well, me and him was about the same age, about 15 or 16, and we used to go on these trips. We would go, we'd catch the L&N out of Drexburg, Louisville and Nashville. We'd catch what they call a local. And we'd go to Central City, then catch the IC. We'd find the empty boxcar. It wasn't a running and catch them, you know, it wasn't that type of thing. We'd just find the empty boxcar and crawl in it. And if it wasn't an empty, we'd just climb up on top of it and sit on the catwalk up there, you know, or on a tanker or in a flat. Our refrigerator car was open, we'd climb down in there, you know. Nobody said anything to us. And we wasn't by ourselves. There was dozens of other guys on. But we'd take a guitar and his mandolin. And we'd sing, harmony, and we'd play and on street corners. Now, the L&N we'd take to Central City, and then we'd climb up the bank, and they had the railroad yards there. And we'd ask a brakeman, you know, in the yard there which one is making up to go to Paducah. He'd show us. Then we'd catch the IC, Illinois Central. We'd catch an IC, they call it the Manifest. That meant it just went straight to Paducah and only stopped one time at Dawson Springs to water up. So we was really chopping in high cotton there. We'd go to Paducah and then get off and go uptown in Paducah and play around on the street corners and take up collection, you know. Pennies, nickels, once in a while a dime. Then we would catch a boat called the Cordella, a little stern wheeler, that went up the Cumberland River to Dykesburg, Kentucky, up the Ohio to where the Cumberland runs into it, then up to Dykesburg, and then it turned around and come back. It would haul a few little barges of this and that, you know, and stopped by the bank and picked up milk and I don't know what all. And we would play. The crew let us ride because they liked to hear us play, they said, you know. So they'd let us eat, and we'd sleep out on the barges or on the deck. Then when we get to Dykesburg and the crew would all go home, we'd stay on the boat. One night we was playing on the streets of Dykesburg, Kentucky, and taking up collection to buy Coca-Cola and cheese and crackers, you know, and pork and beans, and figured we was millions of miles from home. And then we'd go to the boat and climb up and get in the pilot house, you know, and count our money. One night the moon was shining real bright, and we went up there, and it was an awful good night. We just had lots of money in our pockets, you know. And I was counting my part over there, and Junior was counting his, and in the moonlight, he said, here's a penny, and there's six, seven, eight, nine, and directly he started, he said, come here, come here. And I thought maybe the boat was sinking or something. I run over there in the moonlight, and I said, what is it? And he said, here's a quarter. And gee whiz, I was proud of that. So we made that boat trip quite a few times. And then when I was on the radio in Cincinnati on WLW, I used to love to catch the Island Queen and ride up the Ohio to the Coney Island, because I'd sit there and look at the river and the banks and everything. And I was 20 years old then, and I would think about back when I was young, 15, back when I used to ride steamboats, you know, with Junior Rose. So
how many years did you ride the steamboat with him?
Oh, I guess 4 or 5 summers we'd go and ride the steamboat.
So from about the age of 15 to 20, most of your money was made by playing around. Okay, so about from the age of 15 to 20, you were playing around wherever you could, making a living in music.
Yeah, now there was some pretty good little licks hidden there, you might say. In this way, it was a great bunch of experience I had. Because with the boys from Evansville, or the Knox County Knockabouts, we had the little band and played the schoolhouse.
How long did you keep that group going?
You know, just anyways near, I couldn't tell you, but I'd say maybe a year.
Mm-hmm. That's when you were 15 or 16, something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah. Then a fellow named Aud Rhodes.
First, I didn't get all the instruments that were in the group.
Well, I played a guitar, and L.G. James played a guitar, and his brother, Freddie, played a banjo, and then we had a bass fiddle and a fiddle. Mm-hmm. Now, that was the instrumentation of the
yeah.
Knox County Knockabouts.
They were all about your age, too?
Yeah. Freddie was an old man. He was in his 20s. You know how kids are that way, you know?
Yeah.
Then this other act we got with, Aud Rhodes, he worked on the radio there, WGBF and WEOA in Evansville, so we got a band together and called the Tennessee Tomcats.
Were any of you from Tennessee?
Not a single one of us. But Tennessee was very far away, you know. It was we had to go across the southwestern end of Kentucky to get there from Indiana, so we thought that would sound distant and everything. So we was the Tennessee Tomcats, and let's see, there was, I guess there's 5 of us. Had a boy that, all he would announce, you know, he'd do the announcing on the programs and say, so-and-so, tonight we'll be at your schoolhouse auditorium and all that, you know, which used to be a pretty good thing on the bigger stations and bigger bands and better talent. But we'd play, you know, every night that we could. He'd say, come out and see Old Cactus, you know, Cactus from Tennessee, play the bass fiddle with boxing gloves on. And I was Slim. They called me Slim. And then there was a boy named Les Haney, who was from Butler County, Kentucky, down by Morgantown. And we picked and carried on, you know. We played schoolhouses. Then there's three boys from Southern Illinois, Walt and Bill Brown, from Springerton, Illinois, Southern Illinois, and Sleepy Marlin. Well, these three boys come to to Evansville there, and they call themselves the Drifting Pioneers. Well, I finally got a job with them, and they had a beautiful blend, singing trios, you know. And Sleepy played the fiddle, and Bill Brown played the guitar, and Walt played the mandolin. Well, there wasn't much room for me in there playing another guitar, so they put me on bass fiddle. And they bought a bass fiddle, you know, a dollar down, a dollar a week, and we'd tie it on top of the cars. We'd play schoolhouses, and I'd play the bass fiddle, and that's about all. But I worked my way up to playing the guitar, and Bill started playing the bass fiddle and never even touched the guitar. And I become the guitar player. And we sung quartets and trios, and they had a lot of novelty songs. In fact, it was just a lot of talent in that act, excluding me. The rest of them...
No need to do that.
And so we worked around, and one day we got in the car and went to Chicago. We met all the guys at the National Barn Dance. First time I ever met Doc Hopkins was then. That must have been about 1936. And we went around. We auditioned, but we never heard from them because I guess we had the same instrumentation as the Prairie Ramblers. Remember the Prairie Ramblers? Mm-hmm. They was there, and they had a mandolin and a guitar and a bass fiddle and a fiddle. So that was Tex Atchison and Chick Hurt and... Tex Atchison, Chick Hurt, and Taylor. What's his name? His last name is Taylor. And he played the bass. Anyhow, they had the same instrumentation, and right now, to save my life, I can't think of the four. And I know them all very well. That's funny, you know, but that's been a long time ago. Yeah. Well, we wasn't hired there and didn't actually go for a job, but somebody, I think Tex Atchison, suggested that we take the audition. We met a bunch of them, they was all real nice to us, and we just felt wonderful. Well, then we went back to Evansville. Now, there was a fellow named Clayton McMitchin, who was tremendously popular on WHAS in Louisville. Gene Autry would come on from 11:30 to 12, and then Clayton McMitchin come on from 12 to 12:30, and then from 12:30 to 1, Cousin Emmy, and then 1 to 1:30 would be the Atcher family, you know, and some pretty big names in the country field back there. People like Eddie Arnold was working there with Pee Wee King and Eddie Arnold, a bunch of them, you know. Now, I might be mistaken there because Pee Wee King was playing accordion with Frankie Moore and the Log Cabin Boys. Well, when Frankie went somewhere else, Pee Wee started the band, and Eddie Arnold was singing in the trio with Pee Wee then. But now, before I left home, Clayton McMitchin, who I just loved to hear on the radio, and Slim Bryant played the guitar with him, and Jack Dunnigan played guitar and sang, and McMitchin, of course, played the fiddle and emceed, and Loppy Bryant played the bass fiddle. So they played Greenville one time, and I went backstage and told them I was a guitar player. And McMitchin said, "Let me hear you play one." So I started playing, and they'd come around, you know, to see this kid playing the guitar, and it wasn't very good. McMitchin took my name and address and said, "If I ever need you, I'll let you know." Now, this is bouncing back a little ways, you know. Now, I would say another year and a half later, why, the Bryant boys and all the band had gone to Pittsburgh to work on KDKA. And McMitchin had got a new group, Blackie Case, Carl Kottner, who's now Gene Autry's musical director, you know, and Bucky Yates, playing bass fiddle, and they come through Drexburg there, and I'd sold something, milk or something, and had enough money to go to the show. So I was talking with them down in the restaurant there and told them I was the guy that played the guitar for him out there, and Mac Mitchell said, "Oh, yeah." And me and Carl's about the same age, so he listened to me play a little bit, you know, and told Mac, said, "I sure wish he was with the band." Well, now, it was at Evansville, when they played there, and I saw him again, that was the third time I'd saw Mac Mitchin. This is pretty scattered, ain't it?
Well,
I'm trying to recall.
Get it all together.
And Mac Mitchin was playing at the Coliseum, and we was on the show because we was a local act. And I told Mac, I said, I keep looking for that telegram, you know. Well, the year they had the big flood, now that was 36, and then, you know, the last of 36 and 37, you remember?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Mac Mitchin was at Cincinnati then. He just stayed a short time there, however. And we was flooded in there in Evansville, and I was working with the Drifting Pioneers, the Brown Boys and Sleepy Marlin. And I got a telegram from Mac Mitchin. No, I got that wrong. I got a letter from my mother saying that I had a telegram there from Mac Mitchin. They telegrammed it somehow to Central City and then mailed it to Drexburn and mailed it out to the rural route to Ebenezer. And then she'd wrote to me. And he couldn't cross the river because the water was up. But I had to have that job, so I quit the Drifting Pioneers and took off and found a way of catching a boat across the Ohio River at one of the most flooded parts down there. And then I caught a freight train down through Kentucky and got home, which is some 100 miles or so. And there was a telegram and said, meet me in Columbus, which is about 4 days from then. So I started to...
Columbus now.
Columbus, Ohio.
Ohio.
I started gathering up money, you know, friends that had a dollar or two, and I bought a railroad ticket to Cincinnati. And when I got to Cincinnati, they hadn't left yet, so I went on to Columbus, Ohio. And that's when I joined Clayton Mac Mitchin and his Georgia Wildcats. And boy, I was in hog heaven then. And we all wore yellow checkered shirts and everything. And that was a great experience, you know, because we had records at home. And I'd look at Mac Mitchin and think, there is a man who actually made a talking machine record. And he sold them too in his day, you know?
He sure did.
So I was with them some 8 months or something. And finally, the band sort of starved out, you know. And I went back to Evansville and got my job back with the Drifting Pioneers. Now, after so long a time, I couldn't tell you how long, but I think it was March of 1937. We went to Cincinnati.
Who was this, the Drifting Pioneers?
Yeah, Walt and Bill Brown and Sleepy Marlin and myself went to, incidentally, around Evansville, we made pretty good money for that time, you know, playing schoolhouses. Mm-hmm. We was real popular, you know.
You didn't cut any records with Mac Mitchin.
I cut one record called, what is that, Farewell Blues.
Yeah.
Farewell Blues.
And was that released?
Yeah. Now, the other side that I didn't cut with him was some other, I forgot what it was, Trouble in Mind or something like that. On Decca. That was the first record I ever even seen cut. So, we went to WLW and got a job in March, I'm pretty sure, of 1937 with the Drifting Pioneers. And we was there until the Army broke us up. Bill went to the Army and Sleepy, he started teaching flying. He'd been messing around with airplanes. And Walt, he quit and went back to Southern Illinois, and I was left there. I went to the Marine Corps, and I didn't stay very long in the Marine Corps. And when I come back to Cincinnati, well, I worked as a single. Now, I'm ahead of myself again, because I worked there quite a while as a single before I went to the Marine Corps. Now, that's straight. During that time in Cincinnati, I was what they call on staff. I'd done a lot of script shows, reading script, you know, on the soap operas, and this and that, you know. And Hank Richards wrote a show called Rainbow Ridge, and all of us Drifting Pioneers, we done characters with a couple called Clem and Maggie, who was Cal and Bonnie West on the vaudeville stage. And let's see now, what was I going to tell you? Then after the act broke up, well, I worked as a single, and I'd play guitar solos, and I'd sing solos as best I could, you know. And then every morning we had 15 minutes of gospel singing. And whoever was handy would sing in the quartet. Well, the Delmore brothers was working there, and Grandpa Jones, as well as a lot of other people. So the four of us kind of formed a quartet. And we couldn't think of a name for it. And Alton Delmore had wrote a song called the Browns Ferry Blues. So one day I suggested, why don't we call the quartet the Browns Ferry Four? And so we did, and later made some records on it.
And now that was what year that you started?
That must have been 1939 or 40, about 1940, I guess. About 1940. And then Alton went to the Navy, and so that left me and Rabin and Grandpa and just whoever else was handy, Roy Lanham and Essie Martin, a girl, whoever was handy, we'd sang these gospel songs. We got to where we just opened the book and sang. Had a checkered back hymn book there put out by Stamps Baxter. I think it was called Supernal Joy. It had all the goodies in it, all the good quartet, wrote in shape notes. And with this checkered back, Alton called it the Guinea Book, because it looks sort of like a guinea, you know. And we'd grab out the Guinea Book and just sang whatever we opened to, you know, as well as all the other Stamps Baxter and J.D. Vaughan and R.E. Winsett books. So we had a gospel quartet going there every morning. And now you ask a question.
All right.
On that.
Well, I'd like to go back a little bit.
All right.
Now.
All right.
I'd like to go back again to your childhood and your education.
All right. I started to school in the second, we call it the second reader, you know, in the second grade, you would say now. My sister taught me how to, my ABCs, and taught me how to read and write pretty good before I ever went to school. I went to school just a little while at Browder. And I must have been about seven, maybe, you know, I was just before I was seven, I guess. These dates are a little rough to remember. Anyhow, I know that I started in the second grade. So I went for just a little while at Browder School and grade school, naturally. Then when we moved to Ebenezer, there was a one-room schoolhouse there. And so that's where I went to school on through the eighth grade. Now, I had a teacher. The first one was Clavel Tucker. Clavel was spelled C-L-A-Y-W-E-L-L. Claywell, you know, but we call it Clavel. And he'd gone to school to college in Bowling Green. And he wore high-top shoes and a whole lot of chains that he had on his belt all the time. And they jingled. And that was so appealing to me, I just knew when I got grown I'd have me a high-top shoes and a belt with a lot of chains on it. And I imagined I'd look like Clavel. He's a very handsome and rugged-looking fella, you know. But that wore off when he taught a couple of years, and then Miss Cato Lyle come to teach. Then I fell in love with her. She was a very pretty girl and real light platinum, natural blonde hair, you know, and real light blue eyes. And I thought the smartest person on earth was Cato Lyle. We called her Miss Cato. So I went through the eighth grade in a one-room schoolhouse at Ebenezer, at the crossroads there at Ebenezer, Kentucky. The schoolhouse is tore down now. But certainly there's a lot of memories on that place. We used to play Fox and the Hound and Shinny and Marbles and everything else during recess. And the schoolhouse would stay open during the summertime. And one of the best concerts I ever heard in my life was in that schoolhouse.
Hmm.
By a fellow named Mose Reger.
Oh.
He was working with a road crew, and there was a lot of colored guys on the crew and everything. Well, I took this guitar that Taylor built. I took it up there one day at, we call it dinner time, you know. Well, I've learned that this city talk, that's lunch. This middle of the day, you know. Anyhow, they was eating their dinner, and the schoolhouse had no locks, as far as I know. And they was all in the schoolhouse, the Moles and the colored guys and the other white guys was on the road, you know. And I took the guitar up for Moles to play, and he played Memphis Blues and things like that, I remember, in that schoolhouse. And it had the real acoustics, you know. It sounded like electric guitar. I'd never heard electric guitar then, but it sounded so pretty. And boy, I sat there and drooled and thought, boy, someday I'll be able maybe to play like Mose Reger. So that's a concert I heard there.
Hmm. Now, what about your musical knowledge, reading music or anything like that?
I never took a lesson in reading music in my life. Taylor, my oldest brother, always had a knack at learning things pretty quick, and he'd learned dozens of different things. Every time I'd see him, he'd have a different hobby, you know, still does. So one time he got him a trombone in Evansville, and he was working at a factory there called Servell, made the refrigerators and that. So he got him a trombone and taught himself, I guess, to read music, and he got in the brass band. And he showed me a few things about the music, you know, about the lines, that there's an E, let's see, E and G and B and D and E, them, you know, the treble clef, and in between them was F, A, C, E. Well, way years later, I got to figuring out little by little, and I got to where like I work a crossword puzzle, I can sit down and write the lead sheet to a tune.
Mm-hmm.
Or I can write the harmony to four parts or anything, you know, by taking my time. But as far as reading it quick, I can't. Now, shape notes, yes.
You can read shape notes.
Yeah, and here's why. Alton Delmore taught them to me during the time we had the Browns Ferry Four in Cincinnati. He showed me that about the shape notes, and I thought, that's too complicated. But I learned that, you know, every time there is a triangle, you know,
mm-hmm.
that's do, or the tonic note. And, you know, re, mi, and so forth. Mi is a diamond shape, and fa is a long flag, and so is round, and la is square. And I got to where I could look at them, as most all of us did, and know what, by just hitting a chord on the guitar, we'd know what note that was by the shape of it,
mm-hmm.
which is very simple. And I learned that from Alton Delmore. Till today, I can look at shape notes and read them pretty fast. That's about the extent of my music reading. Outside, of course, chord, you know, where they make the little pictures of chord.
Yeah.
I can look at them.
Now, but as a kid, you never went to a singing school or anything like that.
I went to singing schools, but I never paid too much attention to what they was teaching. Because it was too much fun seeing what was going to go on like it was over Jacksonville one night. That was a little place down by an Ebenezer, and it was having a singing school. And me and my brother was down there, John, and the people who lived next to this church there had a cow out in a pen, and she had a bell on. But they had her penned up for some reason, so us boys, we got outside the church. It wasn't necessarily a religious affair, you know, just a singing school. We got out, and my brother, John, he got this bell off of the old cow, and a bunch of us boys got behind him. He started around that church ringing the bell, and we was all hollering and chasing him, and you know, like he was a cow, you know, hollering, hurry there, hurry, heifer, you know, and that bell ringing. And I understand that Mr. and Ms. Vance in the church jumped up and hollered, oh my God, the cow's out. So us boys outside and the Vances didn't have any good out of that singing school that night. So that's the kind of things that went on at the singing school.
So for actually learning to read the shape notes, you didn't learn too much of it from the singing school?
No, I didn't.
Now some more. Did they used to say that you shouldn't dance when you were a kid?
Yeah, that was customary at our house, not everybody's house in the country, it wasn't. But we had play parties, but the idea of having a dance and having a fiddler to come in and a guitar picker or a banjo picker and a fiddler, usually that was the trademark of let's really have a stomp down and drag out, you know. I've been to a Minuan and played for them, but at home we didn't have them. Just naturally didn't, because my mother would say, you know, now you youngins can have a party, a play party, but no fiddling and everything, because that brings in the people who hide their jugs, you know, out under the bushes and sneak out every once in a while, and the party gets real gay when that jug gets down a little piece. But we'd have play parties and hang up lanterns and carbide lamps around in the summertime and get outside, and we'd sing Chase the Buffalo and Skip to Maloo and Rose Beckalina and all these play party songs and Patter Hands, and we'd square dance to them songs. But that was a far cry from going to where the grown-ups that followed the going to dances, you know, where they had fiddling and picking, and they really, when they wasn't dancing and fiddling and picking and carrying on and outside taking a drink, they was outside having some fights, and it got pretty rough.
Well, now, was there any musical accompaniment to these play parties?
No.
You just sing them out?
Just sing them and pat your hands and stomp your feet and everything.
Go ahead.
We had guitars and banjos and things, and when we get tired of playing the games and things, even games with no music to them, like Drop the Handkerchief, you know. We'd get the guitar and all of us would just sing and have a ball playing guitars and banjos and things. We didn't dance to it.
Mm-hmm. You could play the instruments, but you couldn't dance to it.
That's right.
And then you could dance, but you couldn't play the instruments, and you called the dance play party.
That's right. It's sort of like saying, we live here in town, let's go out and shoot. So we go to a shooting range and shoot only in one direction. That's toward that target. So we've gone out and we've had the fun of shooting our guns. But we haven't had the freedom of saying, let's go to war and shoot whoever with that gun, please, and blast, you know.
Yeah.
That's the difference. Because when you get into a battle, while them old boys, they just fire in every direction, you know. Some of them at you and everything. It's a lot different from going hunting and shooting at the game, you know, that spent their whole life in that woods, and you just spend one day out there, you know.
Well, now, what did your parents think about you playing these instruments? Did they think it was sinful or anything?
No, they didn't. Dad always sort of encouraged it, and my mother did too, you know. See, I wasn't the only one, as I told you, you know, my brothers, they was musical. And my sister knew every old song that we ever had on records and some that she'd heard here and there, and she was always singing and everything, didn't play anything. My mother knew a lot of old songs. And Dad, he picked the banjo and played the French harp, as I told you before. And my brother, he could play the banjo better than I could and play the guitar better than I could. Maybe I'm a little better practiced than he is now and might know a few things he don't. I don't know so much about that. But Dad always said, Melvin, he's got a better voice for singing than Merle here. And said, Merle, he just never could get that lick in there on that banjo like Melvin. Melvin always could outpick me on the guitar and on the banjo. If he's here, he's just Irish enough to say, no, I couldn't, you know, because he'll do that.
Well, now, did you ever hear it told that the fiddle and the banjo were the devil's instruments? Any talk like that?
Talk like that? Not in our family. I didn't. The closest I ever heard to that was just a few little things. My mother had a saying of, you know, so-and-so, he can play that fiddle, and said, his fingers going up and down there just like a devil was dancing on the strings, you know? Or picking a banjo or something. I heard her say that a few times. And Dad had a saying concerning musicians, which didn't make any of us look too good. He'd say, I believe the trashiest thing in the world is to see a feller going down the road with a banjo under his arm and a drove of hounds following him. So Dad believed in hard work and not running around with an instrument stuck on your arm and dogs following you, you know?
Yeah. Now, was there anything you said about, like, you say your father played the five-string banjo? Now, did he sing all kinds of songs or just religious songs?
Oh, no. Dad wasn't by any means. I will say this, that by any means, a very religious man. I never heard my dad do any swearing. He never was a man to swear much, and he had a reason for it. He said when Taylor was a baby, it was it was raining one night, and Taylor was about 2 or 3 years old, and my mother said, you better go out and get the goslings up, you know, the little geese. Because when it rains, goslings will follow the stream, you know, and they'll just go plumb off down the branch and you lose them. And besides, they'll drown in the rain, little geese, you know. So Dad, he was putting on his coat, as he called it, his old slicker. He's putting on his old slicker to go out and get the goslings up, and little Taylor, as Dad told it, was running around saying, Pappy, I want to go with you. Pappy, can I go with you? And Dad said, I cussed a little in them days, and said, I turned around to Taylor and said, no, sir, you can't go. He said, you can't go, Taylor. You stay in this house. I said, I got to go put up the damn goslings. And he left, and said when he come back, wringing wet, you know, and mad, said Taylor was standing there sniffing. He said, Pappy, did you put the damn goslings up? And Dad said, ever since then, I ain't cussed none. So Dad wasn't a horribly religious man. I say horribly religious, you know, religious. He didn't try to force any belief on anybody. He enjoyed going to what we call holy roller meetings. That's a Pentecostal or the holiness meetings. He loved to hear them sing because they, like the play parties, stomped their feet and patted their hands and played guitars and organs, and they really made them churches rock, you know. He loved to go to them to hear them sing, and he loved to hear the preacher preach. He'd come home and say, Dadgum, if he didn't get them told tonight, you know. Said, he's one of the best preachers I ever sat under. And my mother wasn't a horribly religious person either. She didn't run it in the ground. So it wasn't that. It was just the idea that didn't want to have a bunch of drinking and fellers out in the yard, you know, cutting one another's knife or blazing away with a pistol shooting at them, you know, or beating one another up with a fist. And some old boy sitting in there with a fiddle, you know, leaning over, like I've seen him do a lot of times. Not always, naturally. But sitting in a chair, you know, and half asleep and still playing the bully of the town. So that's the thing that was dodging. Just mm-hmm. The kids get together and have fun, but let's don't bring in the guys that want to get out and fight and have a fiddling spree, you know. Mm-hmm.
Well, now, what religion were you all?
The best way I could say is just Protestant. Now, I guess the Methodist, Baptist, any of them would fit. just a regular Protestant religion.
Mm-hmm.
Not definitely anything.
Just whatever church you took a notion to go to?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did you go to church a lot when you were a kid?
Yeah, I did. Every year they'd have protracted meetings, you know, at Ebenezer. I'm pretty sure, now here's how, this is awful, but I think Ebenezer's a Baptist church. Don't ever tell them, I didn't know the difference, but I just know that they'd have preaching and singing, and on Sunday they'd have Sunday schools, you know. But during protracted meetings, why, that was quite a ball. That was a big time during the year. Then the other church we'd go to was mostly to flirt with the girls, in my case. It was the holiness meetings and everything. We'd stand outside and look through the windows at them in the wintertime. And in the summertime, when they had outside meetings, why, we'd had a better chance there because the girls would go to the well to get a drink of water, and we'd meet them there, you know. But the singing was good in both the Holiness Church and the church out at Ebenezer. Now, I never saw a Catholic until I was grown, and thereby lies the tale, as it does in everything. Now, I guess our three major religions is Catholic, Jewish, and Protestants. Now, I have heard said that, say, Jew is a religion, and some people refer to it as a nationality. Well, I didn't know of it being a religion, and as far as the nationality was concerned, well, there was some people over at Greenville, his name, Rubenstein. And Dad always said them's the finest people in the world, you know, because it was about the only place in the country where we could get credit other than the company store. It was at Rubenstein's. Uh-huh. And so I never knew that the Jews had any different religion from the Protestants, and I didn't even know there was such a thing as a Catholic, honestly.
Hmm.
And that is my religion story.
Mm-hmm.
A Mormon I didn't even know anything about. The first time I ever heard the word Mormon was an old record that Taylor got somewhere called I'm a Utah Mormon. It was an old blues sort of a song on an old record, and I didn't know what a Mormon was.
I wonder how we're doing here. Just, I want to ask you on the next one about the radio, phonograph, that kind of thing that you had in your home.
All right.
Should we shut this off? And I think it's just about had us. Again, it's July 10th, 1961, Merle Travis. We were just, at the end of the last one, we were talking a little bit about phonographs and radio or whatever you might have had in your house for outside entertainment.
Well, we had one radio in Rob Travis's house, and that one I was lucky enough to present. I bought my dad a little battery radio set when I was working in Cincinnati. Outside of that, we never had a radio. We never had electricity. As far as that's concerned, I never lived in a house with electricity until I left home. We never had rugs on the floor or electricity. We never owned a car. My dad never drove 1 foot in an automobile or lived in a house with electricity, and neither did I.
He never did?
No, until I left home. So I bought him this battery radio, and that's the only radio that they ever had. I wasn't home then. Mm-hmm. We never had a radio as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
My brother-in-law, John Adler, who married Vady, he's dead now. He had the first radio I ever saw. It was one of these jobs that had a whole lot of buttons, you know, across it. You tune all these buttons, and it had one of the big speakers. And Dad thought that was really something. He'd come home and say, "Dadgum, if they ain't about the thought of everything now, you pick up music out of there." And he had a quick sort of memory, I've noticed Dad having. And one night out of KDKA in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, you know, that was one of the early programs, there was a fellow who Dad was just convinced was an Indian, because he said he was. And Dad always said that verse that Indian quoted on the radio was awful good. And Dad, by hearing it once, knew almost all that verse. And all I remember of it was at the end of every verse ended up, fished for fish and hunted for game long before the white man came. And Dad, that struck Dad, you know, and that part struck me and stuff.
Hmm.
Now, well, that was the radio.
When was this? Probably what year?
Oh, gee, that was
when I was maybe, you know, 6 or 7 years mm-hmm. old, maybe 8.
Did you hear that the radio much, or group of people ever go over to the house and make an evening of listening to the radio?
Well, now here's the thing. Frank Travis, who was about the same age as Dad, but actually he was my dad's brother's son, but they, you know, the same mm-hmm. age. Frank Travis, he lived up across the field there from us, and his son-in-law, Beulah Shutt, he had a battery radio and a great big high poplar pole out there with an arrow on it, you know. Now, we used to, the way Dad would say it, well, let's go up to Frank's tonight and radio. So we'd go up there and listen to the radio, and we'd hear the Grand Ole Opry, you know, the Fruit Jar Drinkers and them people down at Nashville in them days, and Robert Lund doing the talking blues every Saturday night. He'd do the talking blues. And then Del Rio, Texas, and Eagle Pass, you know, there was a guy down there named the Lonesome Cowboy. I don't know his name. You might.
I don't know.
He was awfully popular, and he had a little theme song he played on the guitar on 2 strings, which I'll show you someday, sort of how it went. And it sounds so mysterious and so far away, you know. That was my introduction to radio.
You were a little kid then.
Yeah, you know, 10, mm-hmm. 11, something. Now, at the age of about 13 or 14, why, Beulah Shutt moved up on top of the hill towards Beach Creek. And I used to try to make it a point to go up there every day I could at noon to hear Gene Autry and Clayton McMichin and the Log Cabin Boys, you know, and Cousin Emmy. Especially Clayton McMichin and Gene Autry, you know, I like to hear them on the radio. And that was when I got real conscious of the radio.
Mm-hmm.
Beulah Shutt.
Who was Beulah Shutt now?
Beulah Shutt was the reason, no, not the reason. Beulah Shutt was a coal miner, and he lived at Beach Creek, and he married Frank Travis's daughter, Nanny Lee.
Oh.
All the girls had double names. There was Aminelle, Annie Mae, and Nanny Lee. Yeah. And, of course, most of the girls back there do.
Well, now, what about the phonographs?
We had a talking machine. Now, there's one that I just barely remember. I believe I remember it. It might be a power of suggestion. But when Dad lived when we lived at Rosewood, I don't know how he got it, but Dad had a Edison, and he called it a Morning Glory horn, Edison. And he memorized all the old monologues off of the records, you know, Uncle Josh.
Oh, yeah.
And all these people. So, and he had a Morning Glory horn Edison talking machine. Well, he got rid of that, and later, I believe it was Taylor must have got a hold of it some way, a big cabinet job, you know, that we called a Victrola. But actually, this one was called Westrola. And I have no idea who made it. I just wonder if the Western Electric or somebody might have made it. But that was our talking machine, and it, like the fiddle and the guitars and thing, had a smell all its own. Smelled so musical, you know. And I got in there so many times and opened them doors, you know, and take out these records and play them. Now, we ordered stuff when we could get a hold of a little money. We'd order from Sears and Roebuck.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd take 25 cents or something, you know, and order a record from Sears and Roebuck or Montgomery Ward along with the order. So we had Hawaiian music, and we had, of course, Gid Tanner and the Skillet Lickers, and a lot of Clayton McMichin records, you know, and 2 Black Crows. And then Taylor got a hold of some brass band records and some poplar records of the day, you know, which is, we'd call it Dixieland bands now. So that was the talking machine.
What year was that you first had the talking machine in your home, this regular one?
Well, when I was a kid, you know, maybe 7, 8, 9, 10, and plumb on up.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I went to Cincinnati, I took the talking machine. We always called it the talking machine. I took the old talking machine up there after my mother died, and I had it in Cincinnati, and I don't know what I've done with it, but I've got a picture of it. First guitar I ever got, Gibson guitar, you know, was a real dandy, a L10 in the other room here now, you know.
Mm.
I set it down in front of the talking machine and took a picture of it, and I still got it.
I'll be darned. Well, now, the records that you ordered, were they, a lot of these were country music, a lot of them were brass bands, all kinds of things.
I don't think we ever ordered a brass band record, but we'd order Bradley Kincaid, you know, who I work with, you know, on the same radio station. Mm-hmm. And Vernon Dalhart, Carson Robinson, and as I told you, Charlie Poole and North Carolina Ramblers and that bunch, you know. We'd order, they was all advertised in the catalog in them days.
Mm-hmm.
And so with the little money throwed in extra, you know, when the order come, well, here would be the shirts and the this and that and things that we'd order and a record.
Just the record or two would be in a
yes,
order. Yes,
and what a thrill, you know, to go in there and put them on the talking machine and put in a new needle and around she'd go and it just sounded pretty.
Well, how did you decide which records to order?
By reading them in the what the artist was. See, I didn't order them, but my dad did. And he had his favorites, especially Vernon Dalhart and Carson Robinson. So he would just read in there, you know, it'd say Vernon Dalhart, and then he'd give a list of his records, and he would take out this, you know, this record or that one, and order it.
Mm-hmm.
Not without knowing whatever it sounded like.
He had never heard it on the radio
no.
or anything.
Oh, no.
He just liked some artists. Now, how did he got to like those artists originally, like Vernon Dalhart? How did he get so familiar with him?
I'm not sure. I just wonder if Vernon Dalhart made the Edison records. He might have got acquainted with him there.
Yeah, he did.
Well, then that's probably where he fell in love with Vernon Dalhart. And then, of course, Carson Robinson and Vernon Dalhart sang together.
Yeah.
So he probably got some of these duets and it sprang from there.
Well, I think we've talked about this before, that Vernon Dalhart wasn't really country music in the sense that Charlie Poole was. What was the attraction of Vernon Dalhart?
Well, I believe it must be like Jimmy Rogers is quoted as saying, you know, his wife, Mrs. Rogers, Carrie Williamson Rogers, wrote in a book the story of his life, and he said, she just mentioned in there one time that when he wrote a song and recorded it, when he put it on record, he wanted people to make out what he was saying. The chances are that the big love for Vernon Dalhart among country music or country people, you know, was they could make out what he was saying. As you remember, he had a way of saying, you know, it now lies on the shelf. You know, so each word,
yeah.
You could hear every one.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people, if you're familiar with a singer named Tex Carman, he's around Los Angeles here now. Well, he sings, and I just know that he was influenced by them records as a kid and done his best to sing like the record sounded because, you know, you hear every word just as plain, you know, almost
yeah.
like the records of the old
mm-hmm.
time.
Whereas somebody like the North Carolina Ramblers was hard to understand.
Yeah, they was just singing like they would anywhere else, and the fellow was recording it, so there you went.
Mm-hmm. Now, they like the North Carolina Ramblers. Why?
Well, they had a banjo in there, and they had a mandolin, and as Dad said, the finest kind of fiddling, you know, and Riley Puckett, of course, wasn't with the North Carolina Ramblers, but with that type of band, would make them runs on a guitar, you know, doom, 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 little, little, doom, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And there, listen to that man play that guitar, you know, listen to that fiddling. And then when they'd sing things like Watermelon Hanging on the Vine, you know, and the fella hollering in his falsetto voice, it sounded like he was having a big time. So it rubbed off on the listener. So to play a Charlie Poole record, why, and hear him having that big time, why, the listener was also having a big time.
Mm-hmm. So there were different things that appealed. In the one, he could understand the story and all the words, and in the other one, he could have a big time with the good music.
Yes, and 9 times out of 10, it would be a song that, in the case of my dad, he'd say, I've knowed that song all my life. So he was meeting an old friend,
mm-hmm.
and as well as hearing some awful good fiddling and banjo picking, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that, no doubt, was the appeal.
Let's get back up to Cincinnati now.
All right.
The Delmore brothers and you and Grandpa Jones were playing together.
We was on the station together.
Mm-hmm.
See, Grandpa would have his programs and I'd have mine. The Delmore brothers would have theirs. We'd go on tours, you know, playing fairs and theaters, the best of theaters and even state fairs and things, you know. And it was a home folk show and good. I wouldn't mind being on a show like that right now. So we was on the station together. Now, I mentioned our gospel quartets. We would just, whoever was handy, well, we would throw a quartet together.
Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of the personnel left during the war. How about you?
Well, I did too for a while, but then I got back at the just at the before the close of the war.
Before the close of the war, you got back to.
Yeah.
Then you stayed in Cincinnati how long?
I was there 6 years. 6 years, from 37 to 43, I guess.
Does that include the time you were off?
Yeah. Oh, no. No.
You were from there from 37 to 43.
And I left in 43, and then I come out here in 44. That's what I went back there in 44.
And between 37 and 43, part of that time was spent in the Marines?
No. I was in the Marine Corps in 1943, and a little of 44.
And then you...
Then I went back to Cincinnati, and I was there about 2 weeks.
Oh, just then a little time. Yeah. And then you came to California in 44.
Yeah.
And what was your employment out here then, when you came out?
Well, nothing at all. Smiley Burnett, you know Smiley,
sure.
the sidekick with Gene Autry in the pictures, he played a theater called the Albee Theater in Cincinnati, and I just got out of the Marine Corps, and it was cold, and there was a big snow on the ground. I'd been down in South Carolina where it was warm. But I, of course, was raised in cold weather and knew what the winters were. But Smiley was playing the theater there, and I went down backstage to meet him. I had just met him slightly before, but this time I had a visit with him, you know. And he got his guitar out, and I played some on it, and he complimented me, you know, by saying, "Wait a minute, I want Bill Robinson. Remember Bojangles?" Mm-hmm. He was on the bill, too, so old Bill Robinson, the colored tap dancer. He come in and I played some, and Bill Robinson got between the door and the hallway where the marble wasn't carpeted and done a little dance while I played a tune, a buck dance tune I learned from Mose Reger. And Smiley Burnett said to old Bojangles, he said, "That boy could go to Hollywood and stand on the corner of Hollywood and Vine and make a fortune playing that guitar." Well, I was, you know, I'd had a few compliments before that, but I got to thinking it would be nice out there. I said, "Do you like it out there, Smiley?" And here's the words he said. He said, "I'd rather live in California and eat lettuce than to live here in this cold weather and eat caviar." Well, we spent most of that day together, Smiley and I. The next morning I went to WLW radio station, and I kept thinking about that. And we got there before our programs, and I run over the hymns with some of the boys, I forget now who, but Hank Penny was there, and I kept thinking about that. I put my guitar in a case and I set it down, and without going home, getting any clothes, anything, I said to Hank, I said, "Will you drive me to the railroad station?" He said, "Sure." He never said why or anything. I said, "All right, just a minute." I went to Grandpa Jones and to Ramona, who is now his wife, and to one of the girls who's working with them, Jane Allen, and about six people I went to and said, "Loan me $10. And they said, "Okay." I put that with the money I had in my pocket, and I went to Hank and I said, "Let's go." And he drove me to the railroad station because I had in mind to buy me a ticket to Los Angeles. And I got there and I thought, I didn't bring my guitar. And you can see how level-headed I am. I said, "Would you mind driving me back to the radio station? I want to get my guitar." And Hank said, "Sure." Me and Hank was big buddies, you know. And that was in 44. So Hank never asked me anything, and we laugh about that till today. He drove me back, and I went and got my guitar, which was just a flat-top Martin guitar. He drove me back to the radio station, and I said, "Well, so long, Hank." And he said, "Bye." And shook hands. I went in, bought a ticket to Los Angeles and a day coach, and got out here, and I knew two people in town, Wesley Tuttle and Charlie Linville, fiddler. Mm-hmm. So I looked in the phone book, and Charlie wasn't listed, but Wesley was. So I called Wesley Tuttle, who's now an evangelist, you know, a minister. Mm-hmm. And so I called Wesley, and he come down and picked me up, and I went out and stayed a few weeks at his house, and then I rented a trailer and lived up on Ventura Boulevard behind the house in a trailer. It was then mostly open fields. Mm-hmm. So that was how I got here and why.
And you left all your things in Cincinnati?
Mm-hmm. Just walked off and left them.
Oh, these. Now, how about your history in the record industry?
Well, when I got out here,
well, going back to the beginning.
Well, in yes. Well, as I told you, the only record that I ever saw cut, the first record I ever saw cut was Farewell Blues with Clayton McMitch and the Georgia Wildcats. I guess 36 or 37, mm-hmm. something.
And you play the guitar on that?
Yeah. And then, here is the little story about King Records. During singing these gospel songs on these early morning shows, we'd always throw in a spiritual, a Negro spiritual. We'd like to sing them, and I knew quite a few, bunch of them, but not enough. So me and Grandpa Jones, we found a place down on 14th and Central Avenue in Cincinnati, and the man who run it was a fellow named Sid Nathan. And Sid was a short, fat sort of cigar-smoking little fellow, you know, that wore real thick glasses. And we liked Sid, and Sid liked us, and he got used to us coming in saying, "You got any more good spirituals, you know, about colored singers?" And we'd buy blues songs, you know, as well as spirituals. We'd buy these quartets and learn them and then sing them ourselves, you know. And finally, Sid one day said, "Why don't you boys make some records of your own?" And Grandpa Jones said, "Ain't nobody ask us." And Sid said, "Well, I'm going to make some records," said, "I'm going to start pressing them." He said, "Why don't you boys record for me?" Well, we said, "It's against our contract at WLW." So Sid said, "Well, we'll fix that. We'll slip out of town." And Grandpa said, "Well," me and Grandpa, you know, said, "We'll do it, but we'll have to change our names." He said, "That's all right, just as long as I got your own records." So he said that he had everything all fixed one day, and me and Grandpa Jones and Sid Nathan slipped out of Cincinnati and went to Dayton to cut records. Now, on the way up there, we got deciding what we would cut. And Sid said, "Why don't you boys write some songs?" So we started throwing songs together, and we wrote four songs to record. Now, we stopped by cornfield, and Grandpa wanted to take a look at the cornfield, and me and Sid was waiting in the car, and I do believe that the first time that Sid Nathan ever said King Records was at that time, because he was sitting there trying to think of something to call his records, and the name this and that come up, and finally he said King, something about a king. He said, "That'd be a good name, King Records." And then, being the smart businessman that he's proved to be, he said, "King Records, that's it." Said, "I'll call it King Records." And said, "On it, it'll say King, the king of them all, you know." And so me and Grandpa, then we started to try to think of a name to call ourselves as a singing duet. Grandpa had a habit of sitting down, and when he talked to you, he would draw a little cartoon, you know. Always the same, a little man in long handle underwear holding a kerosene and coal oil lamp, you know. We call them coal oil, kerosene lamp. And he said, "That's Mr. Shepherd." I said, "Why do you call him that?" And he said, "Because we used to live by a feller that looked like that, you know." And so on the back of sheet music and songbooks and everything, even till now, I turned and there's Mr. Shepherd holding his lamp. Well, I got to thinking about that, and I looked at Grandpa and I said, "Why don't we call ourselves the Shepherd Brothers?" And we got to laughing about it, and he said, "Okay." And Sid said, "That's good enough." So we went to Dayton and cut four sides for King Records. That was the Shepherd Brothers, and that was the first King record was ever made. Finally, they was released, and I took home a copy, and I put it on the machine. I had a Wilcox Gay, you know, a home recording outfit, but also a playback. And it turned round and round and round and round, and I don't know how many grooves, and finally here come a distant voice of me and Grandpa. Sounded like it was way off in the barn. Well, I didn't save one of the records, but Grandpa did. I wish I had one now. That was the first recording.
What were those records?
I remember the Steppin' Out Kind was one of them, and Heart Stealing Mama, I think, was one. I don't know. Right now, I can't tell you the names of them.
They were all things that you and Grandpa wrote.
Just made them up on the spur of the moment, you know.
Mm-hmm. Were they pretty good?
No, they were pretty bad. But, you know, Grandpa has later, Grandpa re-recorded Steppin' Out Kind and a couple of songs we done on that, and it wasn't too awfully bad, especially with Grandpa done.
Well, now, then what was your next recording?
Well, I didn't do any more recording until I come to Hollywood.
Well, no, wait, you did some with the Brownsbury Four.
Yes, but that was here.
That was here?
Yeah. When I come to Hollywood, why, I got acquainted after so long a time with just about everybody in around town, you know, the country musicians around Southern California here. And my old friend Sid Nathan, he called me one day on the telephone and he said, "I'd like for you to be A&R man."
for King Records. And I said, what's an A&R man? He said, you know, artist and repertoire man. He said, you find anybody you want to out there if you think they got talent, and you set up a studio, and you get the musicians you want or that they want, however many, you know, and the songs that they want to do, and record them. Said, you sit in the control room, and then I said, oh, they, yeah, sure, because I've been in on a lot of recording sessions. I just, they didn't use the word A&R man then as much as they, mm-hmm. but Sid Nathan said it first, as far as I was concerned. So I was A&R man for King Records, and I recorded Leon Rusk, and the Fiddlin' Linvilles, and Tex Acheson, and Jimmy Widener, and, I don't know, a whole bunch of people. I never did have a hit, but I had some songs on the King Records that later become pretty big. So I was A&R man for King Records, and it was a pretty good little thing. Now, one day I was playing guitar on a recording session for Belltone Records, which I don't think is in existence now. And the man recording was Smiley Burnett, and three girls were singing with him, and they were called the Sunshine Girls. That was Vivian Earls and June Widener and Colleen Summers, who later married Les Paul and changed her name to Mary Ford.
Hmm.
So they were the girl trio, and Smiley Burnett was his session. He recorded This My Lazy Day, and
mm-hmm.
a few things like that. And I was there, and they had a song called Hominy Grits. And Smiley said, why don't you sing this? Because I like to try to sing stuff like this. And I said, oh, no, you go ahead. And he said, no, you sing it. So I sung Hominy Grits. And Smiley said, we'll release that on the record. And I said, well, don't put my name on it. Actually, it sounded mm-hmm. bad to me. It still does. So I don't know who made up the name, but they released it under the name of Tim Martin. Hominy Grits by Tim Martin.
And what was on the flip side of that?
I think one of Smiley's tunes.
Oh, just the one side with you.
Mm-hmm. So there was Tim Martin on Belltone Records. Then a fella, I cannot call his name now, come to me, and he was from Gold Records. He said, I'd like for you to record for us. I said, good. So I got together a bunch of the boys, and I cut a session for Globe, and I said, I don't want to use my own name on it. I don't know why, but I thought maybe something better would come along, and I thought the record sounded pretty bad. And they wanted a ballad and a pretty fast little song. So I sung I'm All Through Trusting You, a song that Shug Fisher wrote. Well, I wrote a song called Cincinnati Lou, which they didn't like. So I told Shug, I said, I'll swap you half of Cincinnati Lou for half of I'm All Through Trusting You. So we made the trade, and I recorded I'm All Through Trusting You on Globe, and on the other side was I Used to Work in Chicago. Now, I've got that record here now, but the name I used was Dusty Ward.
Now, just one record came out under the name Dusty Ward.
Yes, as far as I know.
Mm-hmm.
Now, years later, I made a dub record, you know, a dub record mm-hmm. for Sid Nathan one time in Cincinnati, of a song that a fellow named Roy Starkey wrote. It was called When Mussolini Laid His Pistol Down. So I made this record for Sid so his other artists could learn it, somebody else, you know, in King. And years later, he released that under the name of Bob McCarthy, and it's me picking and singing When Mussolini Laid His Pistol Down. Well, there's Bob McCarthy and Dusty Ward and Tim Martin. Then there was a fellow named Douglas Venable who wanted to get our voice on some acetate records when we was doing a program with Cliffy Stone over KXLA, which was Pasadena then. And me and Tex Acheson and Red Merle recorded some trios, and this boy took the voice track, you know, on acetate records and put it on some little records called Lariat. And it says, and That's All was on it, and Texas Home, Here I Come, a little old song I wrote. And it said there, Merle Travis on both sides. So I got that record here.
That was the first one that had the name Merle Travis
yes.
on it.
Uh-huh. Then, Cliffy Stone thought maybe that I could was good enough to record for a new company called Capitol Records. So he talked to Johnny Mercer, who was a A&R man for them then, and Lee Gillette, and they listened to me on the radio, and I went down one day, and they said, we'd like to make some records with you. Can you write some songs? I said, sure. They said, okay, you write some songs and come back and record them. So I said, what'll I write? And Cliffy said, well, I'll see if I can think of something, you know. So over the weekend, Cliffy Stone and his wife, Dorothy, and Sylvester Cross, president of American Music, and his wife, Frances, went to Palm Springs to spend a weekend. But they couldn't find anywhere to stay. And they looked everywhere and couldn't find anywhere to stay, so they come all the way back home. And Cliffy said, I'll tell you a good song to write. Said, you ought to write a song called No Vacancy. Said, that's all we saw all the way up there. And I said, okay, I will. I'll give you half of it. So I sat down and made up a song called No Vacancy, and that was my first record.
That was for Capitol.
Uh-huh. And on the other side, I recorded Cincinnati Lou, the one that I traded with Shug Fisher. And it went pretty good. It got...
Now, well, what do you mean when you say you traded it?
With Shug Fisher?
Yeah.
Well, because I needed a ballad and didn't have one for Globe Records. And they didn't want like Cincinnati Lou. And Shug had this I'm All Through Trustin' You, which was a ballad. And I said, this Cincinnati Lou's no good. I'll put your name on it as co-writer if you put my name on I'm All Through Trustin' You. And he said, it's a deal. So we did. And later, Cincinnati Lou, I guess, sold a million. And I'm All Through Trustin' You is a relic that I wouldn't trade anything for. So then I was on Capitol Records by that deal, and my first few records went pretty good. And today I was talking with Ken Nelson. I'm to re-record them August 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th.
Which ones are you going to re-record?
All the first records, 12 of the first records I made for Capitol.
Very good. With a group?
Uh-huh. It'll be sort of the same sound with a trumpet. I used a trumpet and a clipped rhythm on the first records I made to try to be a little different, you know. But we'll have three fiddles and a drum and a piano and a bass and a trumpet and a rhythm guitar and myself on this session.
Well, that'll be real good.
And it'll be for an album, and if Capitol Records are as smart as I think they are, they'll call it Merle Travis, America's Worst Singer and Most Overrated Guitar Player.
Well, if I have any hand in it, they won't.
I'd like to have you come down to the session.
I wish I would be in town. But I'll be back there.
Oh, that's right. No, oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Well, how's our tape done?
Well, we've got just a little bit more on there that we can talk a little bit more about. The only thing I didn't get from you is when you got married. And
well, the first time I got married, I was 19. I married a holiness preacher's daughter by the odd name of Mary Johnson. So I married Preacher Johnson's daughter. We had a daughter then. Her name was, she was a girl, naturally, being a daughter, so we named her Patricia Adeline Travis. And her name is Pat. And as we are making this tape, she's outside here now with my present wife, Betty. I believe she's the only person I ever met whose initials spell her name, P-A-T.
Oh, yeah, right.
Now, I was married then to a girl singer named Judy Hayden, and we had two daughters, and that marriage went the way of so many marriages, too many. And now I'm married to the former Betty Morgan, and we have a wonderful home and a happy family life. And I think you'll agree Betty's a pretty nice gal.
I sure do.
One especially good thing, her mother is from Litchfield, Kentucky.
Oh, yeah?
She hits me when I say that. She was born in California, Betty was.
Yeah, she said she was born here in the Valley, or in Burbank.
No, she was born, I believe, out in Firestone Park. Down that neighborhood.
Now, when did you marry Betty?
6 years ago.
6 years ago.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Well, I think that's about this whole tape.
Okay.
I've got a lot of more things which I don't think we're going to be able to get to.